You dwell in the songs that we are singing, rising to the heavens, rising to your heart, our praises filling up the spaces in between our frailty and everything you are. You are the keeper of my heart. And I'm restless till I rest in you, till I rest in you. I am restless. I'm restless till I rest in you, till I rest in you, O God. O speak now, for my soul is listening. Say that you have saved me. Whisper in the dark, the dark. As I know you're more than my salvation, without you I am hopeless. Tell me who you are. You are the keeper of my heart. And I'm restless till I rest in you. Till I rest in you. I'm restless, till I rest in you. Till I rest in you. Still my heart, hold me close, let me hear. A still small voice, let it grow, let it rise into a cry, oh. And I'm restless till I till I rest in you. I am restless, so restless, till I rest in you, till I rest in you, O God. O God.
Welcome to Reveille's virtual worship service on the second Sunday of Easter. Whether you are a member of our church or viewing this worship service as a visitor, we welcome you this day. I want to remind you that if you have any prayer requests this day, please feel free to visit our website, reveilleumc.org. And you can submit prayer requests, joys, or concerns for our prayer ministry team to lift up during the week. And you can also send in requests that we can use in our prayers of the people during these worship services. Let us now prepare our hearts and minds to worship the living God. I invite you to join me now for our opening prayer. Let us pray. Lord of life, submitting to death, you conquered the grave. By being lifted on a cross, you draw all peoples to you. And by being raised from the dead, you restore to humanity all that we had lost through sin. Throughout these 50 days of Easter, we proclaim the marvelous mystery of death and resurrection. And especially this day, we ask that you would breathe on us your peace and your Holy Spirit to sustain us and guide us and help us through our days. We praise you, O Lord, now and throughout all eternity. And we ask all these things in the name of your risen Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hello, children of God. I'm Tammy, and last Sunday we celebrated the good news of Easter. And today, the Reverend Kelly Lane is going to be telling a Bible story from the book of John, chapter 20. And this story happens after Jesus has risen from the dead. The disciples were meeting in a room with the door shut tight. They were scared. And suddenly, Jesus showed up right in the middle of them all. It was a miracle. And the Bible tells us that Jesus breathed the Holy Spirit onto the disciples. And the Holy Spirit was like a breath of fresh air. And it filled all of the disciples with such joy, and it gave them courage to leave the room and go and share the good news with others. And now I want you to try something with me. I would like for you to sit up as tall as you can. Everyone can try this. And I want you to breathe in through your nose and exhale out of your mouth. Make as much noise as you can as you breathe in. You're breathing in the peace of Jesus. And exhale out of your mouth. And one last time, deep breath in through your nose. Breathing in the joy of Jesus and exhale out of your mouth. Don't you feel like you've been given new life? It's wonderful. Will you say a prayer with me now? Repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for Jesus, who gives us joy and new life in you. Amen. Now remember to breathe and share the joy.
Let us pray. Eternal God, send your Holy Spirit upon the reading of your word, that it may serve to show us the path of life and lead us into your presence where there is fullness of joy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our reading today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 19 through 29. Hear now the word of God. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And he said this. He showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nail in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. When I was 9, my small town United Methodist Church decided to celebrate Easter with an outdoor sunrise service. I remember this service well for two reasons. One, it was the first time we had ever done anything like that. Yes, it was a church, and yes, we did something new. And two, it was so beautiful. The whole congregation gathered in the dark, just outside of town on a bluff overlooking the river in the early morning hours. As we began to sing and pray, the sun slowly made its appearance on the horizon line. During the 1 hour of the service, the sky changed from complete darkness to us being able to view a slight pink sun on the horizon line and yellow and pink clouds being in the sky, to yellow, pink, and red clouds filling the entire sky, and then a bright blue sky appearing, and it was a sunny Easter morning. I hate to say I don't remember any of the words of the message or the scriptures that we read or the hymns that we sang. What I do remember is the move from darkness to light, and that the whole congregation was gathered there together to witness this marvelous display put on by nature. Because I remember this sunrise service from my childhood so fondly, when in 2004, Trinity announced they were having a sunrise service, I excitedly informed my then young children that we would be attending that service. I eagerly explained to my three-year-old twins and their older siblings that we would hunt for our Easter eggs when we got home after the service. Miraculously, all four children were dressed and ready to go, and we arrived in time in the garden, ready for what I thought was going to be an amazing sunrise service. But we live in Virginia, and it was cold. It was not like Easter in Texas. And as we stood there here in Virginia, in the dark, wrapped in our winter clothes, we were shivering. The skies that were gray remained gray. We didn't witness a beautiful sunrise at all. It did go from dark to light, but there were no beautiful, colorful clouds. My children were so relieved and happy when we returned home and we got to begin hunting Easter eggs. I learned a hard lesson that day. Telling someone about my experiences of Jesus is important, but it is not the same thing as them seeing Jesus for themselves. Today in our scripture, John tells the story of Jesus' Easter appearance to the disciples. It is evening. The disciples are gathered behind closed, locked doors, even though Mary Magdalene has already shared the good news of Jesus' resurrection with them. Like my children, they have heard the Easter story, but it is not yet real for them. So Jesus comes, he stands among them, and he greets them, "Peace be with you." He shows them his wounds, and the disciples rejoice. Then Jesus breathes the Holy Spirit upon them to empower them for mission, and he sends them. But Thomas isn't there. He misses Jesus' appearance. And when the disciples share the good news with him, he insists that he won't believe it unless he can see Jesus for himself and touch Jesus' wounds. So Jesus comes. He greets Thomas just as he greeted the other disciples a week earlier. "Peace be with you." And he reveals his wounds to Thomas, and Thomas touches them. And Thomas exclaims, "My Lord and my God." Almost immediately after he records Thomas's transformation from doubt to belief, John declares that he is recording these stories so that we too might come to believe and have life in Jesus' name. What exactly do these final words of our passage mean? And that through believing, you may have life in his name. How are belief and life in Jesus' name connected? For many of us, belief in the resurrection and in life after death proves to be one of the most challenging tenets of our faith. Yet, as Christians, it is foundational to our faith. Each time we repeat the words of the Apostles' Creed, we declare, "We believe in the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting." Furthermore, as United Methodists, we believe that both resurrection and eternal life are available here, now, and in the future after life here on earth ends. It is not an either-or proposition. In his first letter to the early Christians in Corinth, Paul insists upon the importance to the Christian faith of belief in Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. He maintains resurrection after physical death means, quote, "a new life in a new body." He describes it as an earthly mortal body transformed into an immortal spiritual body. And throughout his gospel, John continuously links Jesus' resurrection with life. In the first chapter of his gospel, John writes, What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. In John 10, Jesus tells his listeners he comes so that all people might have life and have it abundantly. In John 11, Jesus declares, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." Jesus brings life, new life, abundant life, eternal life, life that is available here and now. In his commentary on today's scripture passage, Will Willimon writes about a class in which he and his students were discussing difficult Christian beliefs. When many expressed they had problems believing in the resurrection, one woman spoke up. "Well, I do believe in the resurrection. I've seen it, I've lived it. When my husband walked out on me, I could have died. I did die. My life was over, dead end. But then, by the grace of God and with the coaxing of good friends, I came back. I came back to life. I got a whole new life. It was a miracle. I believe in the resurrection because I've lived it." Jesus' resurrection gives us hope, enough hope, so that even on our darkest days, we can go on because we know the truth of the good news we celebrate, not just on Easter, but on every day. The Lord is risen. He is risen indeed. As Easter people, we are called to share our Easter stories. My children may never experience a sunrise service quite like the one I did, but they have their own stories now. One tradition they have grown to love is helping to serve Holy Communion at Reveille during the 11 o'clock service on Easter. Serving Holy Communion, especially on Easter, is an overwhelmingly beautiful and grace-filled experience. Hundreds of people join together around one table, receiving the elements of the sacrament while remembering Christ's gifts of love and grace that are freely given to all. As we give thanks for these gifts, our spirits are renewed and we are strengthened for our journeys of faith. It is indeed a holy mystery. Not only are the members of our congregation present, but also Christ is mysteriously present with us, as is the whole communion of saints. We receive a foretaste of the heavenly banquet, and God sends us, like the early disciples, out in mission. Unfortunately, this year, our congregation could not gather in Reveille Sanctuary and celebrate Holy Communion. My family could also not go to our friend Joy's house for lunch after the Easter service, like we usually do. Life is really challenging right now. On some days, it looks dark and bleak and dismal. But then I remember, during my lifetime, the world has experienced many struggles and challenges, from the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. and the war in Vietnam, to the AIDS epidemic in the 1980s, the terrorist attacks on 9/11, and horrific school shootings. And although these events have changed us forever, we have managed to survive. God has been with us as we grieve our losses and heal from the pain. God has given us new life and empowered us to continue the mission of reconciliation, grace, and peace given by Jesus to the disciples on that first Easter evening. This year, we had to experience Easter in a new way, a way that is strange for us, but also reminds us of the importance of our faith to us and how much we need and value our relationships with our neighbors, friends, and family. Our congregation worshiped online, and members sent each other pictures of the cross in front of the church decorated with flowers. Sunday school classes met on Zoom, and whole families met on Zoom. My family had 15 members who met on Zoom. It was not the same as all being together in one place, but it was okay because we all knew we are doing our part to help end this horrible pandemic. As Easter people, we are called to share the good news of the resurrection with the world. Last week, a friend shared a photo of the Resurrection Chapel at the National Cathedral. Behind it, there is a rising sun, much like the rising sun you see on the banner that I made from the flowers that the children painted at kids' camp. In the picture of the Resurrection Chapel, you see the triumphant Christ standing because Christ has triumphed over death. Another friend shared other pictures with me. She shared some pictures of sunrises in national parks. The first photo is of Crater Lake, and the second is from Sprague Lake. All of these images remind us that after the darkness, the sun does rise. You see, life is dark now. Not only are many people getting sick, and some of them are dying, but also many have been laid off from their jobs, and many are unable to attend school. And sometimes it seems especially bleak because we aren't sure when all of this will end, but it will end. The dawn will come, and the sun will rise. Our God is a God who parts the Red Sea, who breathes new life into dry bones, and who raises Christ from the dead. This same God is at work in our world, here and now, healing, transforming, and bringing new life. Oddly enough, we are seeing some positive benefits from so many people being forced to stay home from work. Scientists have noted air pollution and traffic are down in all major metropolitan areas. Power usage is down across the board, and the earth is quieter. Where once seismologists could register the traffic near the sites they were monitoring, now they can note seismic activity in countries halfway around the world. And fish and marine life are returning to areas they once avoided because of the noise of cruise ships and other leisure vehicles. In addition, people are taking a break from the frenetic pace of life in the 21st century. They are staying home and cooking, baking bread, playing games, reading, and doing puzzles. And we all have a new gratitude for teachers, for everyone who works in the healthcare world, and for all who help to supply our food. And most amazingly, we have proof that the whole of creation is really connected, that governments can work together for the common good, that citizens can sacrifice their personal desires for the health of others, and that good can result from these efforts. All of these positive effects cause me to wonder, what if, after we find a vaccine for this horrible virus, what if we are able to make positive and permanent changes that transform our world for the better? Our God is, after all, a God who uses all things for good. And God is a God who hears our cries, who cries with us in our pain, and who also brings new life. We have hope because we know Christ's resurrection is real. Let us be the Easter people God is calling us to be. In the name of the risen Christ, amen.
And now let us join our hearts and minds in praying for our church, community, and world. using the call and response, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Resurrecting God in a doubting world, keep us in faith that we may have life. We pray for the Church universal. Breathe on us your Holy Spirit that we may honor and pass on the great inheritance we have received. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the earth, that we may touch its wounds with healing care and love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the whole world, its nations, its leaders, and its people, that your wisdom and peace may prevail. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those in need, the suffering, the oppressed, the ill, the dying, and those who care for them, and those who grieve. We especially pray this day, Lord, for those who are on the front lines of caring for those who are suffering from this coronavirus. We pray for your healing of the sick and your protection upon those who are well. And we pray for those who grieve, especially those who grieve in isolation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for ourselves, our families, and those we love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Blessed are you, O God, who through Jesus Christ, crucified and risen, and in the community of the Holy Spirit, gives us an inheritance that is imperishable and unfading, now and forever. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we ask this, and we ask all things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we prepare to receive this morning's offering and hear our beautiful offertory, I want to thank you for your continued generosity and support of ministries here at Reveille United Methodist Church. If you would like to support the ministries of our church financially, you may do so by going to reveilleumc.org and clicking on the green button that says Give Now. Thank you for your generosity. Your giving enables us to do God's work in this place and in this community. Thank you.
May the God who loves and resurrects us breathe the Holy Spirit upon you, giving you new life and hope. And may the blessing of God, the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, be with you now and always. Amen.